Can you imagine when we're in our own facility where there's no sweet 16 birthday party and pots and pans and dishwashers in the room behind us? Can you imagine?
Yes, I can.
We pray for them. Like, oh, whoa. This has not hindered the Lord one bit. But when we move in our own facility, there'll be no distractions, no disruptions, nothing in the airwaves that is displeasing to him. He just amazes me how he is here. He comes. His presence is so beautiful, so tangible. If you haven't felt the glory yet, if you haven't felt his presence yet, I just want to encourage you right now, just whether you haven't felt it or have, but just put your hands up and be a receptor. Do you understand what that means?
Yes.
A receptor is like an outlet that you plug a plug into, a receptacle. Yeah. Because I can preach on the glory, I can teach on the glory, but until you experience the glory. And Lord, I thank you for giving us experience. I thank you for giving us taste, eyesight and ears, to hear, behold, to see. The Apostle John said, that which our eyes beheld, that which our hands touched, that which our ears heard, we heard the word of God. We heard the word that became flesh. We heard him. We touched him. We beheld him. We beheld his glory. Take your church to that place again, God. Take us to that place. Like the first disciples that saw and experienced you. And then Paul, it was through the revelation in the Spirit, God. He wasn't there, but then he met you on the road to Damascus. And he met you. And then he beheld you. And then he touched you. And then he heard you. God, do it again. Do it again. Do it again for everyone in this room and for those that are to come, because many are coming. Do it again, Lord. Show us your glory. Let us experience the tangible, manifest presence of God. I want you to know that there are angels in this room. This happened to me one Tuesday night when we were praying. I felt a presence go right by me, and I thought someone was coming up to take the mic, but they weren't. And then Ken saw this angel standing next to me, and then when I was just feeling the glory and I just was saying, Lord, I just want to see your face, just to myself, to the Lord, I just felt this presence, huge, walk right in front of me, and I almost fell over. And I said, oh, they're here. They're here. The angels of the Lord. It doesn't matter what's going on down the hall. Isn't that something? Isn't that amazing? It is. It's amazing. It is. They're bundled up with blankets and coats. I am so hot. There's no vent on this side when you're preaching in this room. It's just bad setup. You guys are freezing and it's just hot up here. There's no air here. I am sorry. We should reverse the room and put me on that end, right? Yeah, that's what we need to do. Oh, Lord, I'll keep you awake. Praise God. Oh, I want to talk about the glory of God. I want to talk about it, but I want the spirit of revelation between my mouth and your ears, that tonight will be the beginning and the next weeks ahead, because this will be several weeks of talking about the glory and experiencing the glory, that you'll receive the revelation. I have more revelation than I can verbalize. I really do. It's so experiential, but it's so spirit. How do you describe spirit? When you're explaining salvation to someone who's never experienced being born again, and you're trying to describe to them what happened to you when you became born again, and you're like, well, my eyes opened, and I could see, and I could feel, and but they don't get it yet until they can see and they can feel, you know? So I have, when I say more revelation, it's not like I'm perfected in this, but it's hard to put in words and verbalize God's glory. I have felt it. I have experienced it. I know when he's there. I feel like I live in it. My favorite word is glorious. I feel that to me is, the Lord is glorious. He is just so glorious. And you can't put him in a human word. You just can't describe God in a English word. God is spirit. And God is supernatural. So when you take something that's natural and you put super on it, that doesn't even describe it, because God's not Superman, you know, like we make super, you know, but that's an English word, supernatural. Do you understand that? We're trying to put into English words a description of a being that is beyond our human ability to comprehend. So I can only pray that the spirit of revelation, like, you know how someone's talking and all of a sudden your eyes go, I see something I didn't see before. And it's not this kind of eyes, it's an understanding, a glimpse. It's like you get this little glimpse into the spirit realm of something that's there all the time. It's always there. God's always there. The revelation is always there. He's always speaking. One of my opening scriptures tonight is Psalm 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God. The heavens declare it. Growing up as a little child and even into my teen years, I never knew God, but I saw him in the revelation of his creation. Does that make sense? The heavens were declaring to me that there is a God, and he's real, and he's there. I didn't know how to get to him. I didn't know how to experience him, but yet heaven was declaring to me, I'm real. There's a creator, and this is my creation. In Psalm 19, verse 1, well, even in the whole Psalm of 19, there's two revelations that David is receiving about God and about his glory. The first half of the psalm, he's talking about what he sees with his natural eye. He's talking about the heavens and how they're declaring God's glory, and day and night they're speaking. And there's nowhere that the voice of God's creation isn't heard. You can go to the farthest end of the earth and the heavens will still be declaring the glory of God.
Oh my gosh, that just, I don't know why, but that just turns me on spiritually. The fact that David, he had so much revelation of the Lord. He said, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I make my bed in the pit of hell. Oh, this old rock religion right out the door. You are there.
Yes, that's right.
That was a comforting scripture to me when I pray for my kids. No matter how far you ran, even into the pit of hell, he was there. And the heavens were declaring his glory to my kids, no matter whether they were in a bar or out on drugs or in the den of iniquity somewhere, didn't make a difference. We got to see God as he really is, not as our fears and our minds dictate. The heavens declare, that word declare means speak out, tell. But it's more than that. It means that they declare with the authority of heaven. The heavens are saying, thus says the Lord. You did anybody see the sky on the way here tonight? That's all I could get out of. I was like, Lord, you are declaring your glory right there. There was, instead of a rainbow, I don't know if you saw it, a dark cloud in the shape of a rainbow. From one end to the other, the sky was like a pinkish orange glow. And then there was this dark cloud of a rainbow. Rainbow shaped. It went, the clouds, do you ever see clouds go down like this? They did. It was phenomenal. And I couldn't help but think of the scripture where Elijah saw the cloud in the distance. But God combined the cloud with the rainbow. And he said, I'm promising that cloud. I'm promising the cloud the size of a man's fist. The heavens declare his glory. This is a natural revelation of who God is. The second part of Psalm 19 talks about scriptures and what the word of God does. Now, this will take you to another level in your understanding, but just the way the heavens declare God's glory because they speak, the word of God is speaking and declaring God's glory. There is so much glory to be held and to partake of. We have to get a hold of this. The heavens is used of two primary locations, or two primary senses. Let's put it that way. You have the natural senses and you have the spiritual senses. Correct? So in the natural, the heavens are the created universe. Everything above the earth, stay with me, the sky, the lights in the sky, all the stars, the comets, anything you see up there, all the lights, the moon, the sun, everything seen in the sky, in the physical universe, the heavens are viewed as the voice of God. The voice of God that speak. This is revelation because I can't give this to you. But the heavens are also viewed in a spiritual realm. The heavens are viewed in the spirit realm, in the realm of heaven. Now, stay with me. If the first layer of heaven is what you're seeing, and you're seeing thunderstorms, hailstorms, rainbows, stars, sky, planet, moon. You're seeing all of this. And that's just the first layer of heaven. And he says, the heavens declare my glory, and that there are two more levels of heaven above that. How big, how enormous is God's creation? Because we only see the natural realm. But above this natural realm, which is bigger than the eye can see, bigger than the strongest telescope can find, right, is a spirit realm of heavens. And that realm, the second realm, has all the spiritual principalities and powers and angels, and there's a whole realm of supernatural activity that we can't see with this eye. A second heaven. When you say, oh, I've been in warfare all week. Have you really? Have you been up in the second heaven? Have you been warring with the demons and principalities and powers, or did you just get a little aggravated? But then there's a third heaven. And that's where God sits enthroned with all the angelic hosts and all the saints who died for thousands of years. All up there. That one verse, Psalm 19:1, the heavens declare the glory of God. You're all looking at me because I understand. How many times do you read that one little verse? One little verse, the heavens. But how much revelation of God is in that verse? God lives in heaven. One of my most amazing scriptures that I just love is in Isaiah, where God says, I live in heaven, but yet I dwell with the humble and contrite heart. It's amazing. In the light of what I just said, and I can't even scratch the surface of the reality of this. What did God just do tonight? He just showed you that. There's a party going on. There's pots and pans and workers screaming and shouting and singing and listening to their Latin music back there and having a good old time. And God said, I live up here. You can't even see where I live. It's not even in the heavens you see. It's not even in the second heavens. Far above. Far above. Far above. I live. How big is God? I live up there, but yet I will come and dwell with the humblest, most contrite heart. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And I'm going to take this another step and say, most of the church misses this. Seriously. Most of the church isn't looking for him. Church to them is this level. Are you getting that?
Yes.
Church to them is what I see here on this level. What kind of building am I in? What kind of chair am I sitting on? What kind of worship do they have? Hello? How long is the sermon? How long are the announcements? What time can I get out of here? It's nice, and I live at the Jersey Shore. This level. That's your perspective of church and God. But God said what? Oh, this is really going to blow your mind now. You have been seated with Christ in heavenly places, far above all principalities, second level, and powers, far above. Listen, what you deal with down here, I call ankle biters. That's all those little devils are down here. Ankle biters. Yip, 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 yip. Which is why we go like this. And we squash. Second level. His principalities and powers that rule and reign over regions. Over nations. Michael the archangel came to war with the prince of Persia. The prince of Persia wars for Israel. They were warring not here. Think about, we're having TNT Tuesday night. This wasn't in my notes or anything, but think about that. What are we doing? Don't think church. Think the heavens declaring the glory of God. And when you view the heavens, it says that they utter speech, that they're speaking. Well, that makes the Democratic Party or the Liberal Party or any other opposing party really seem small. Don't get mad at me. I'm just talking about those that are on the media. Satan is the prince of the power of what? The airwaves. But those airwaves are where? Here. But we're far above. We're far above. Ooh. Thank you, Lord. Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. We need to be tapping in to where God is. Tap into where God is. The heavens, emphasized Bible says, are telling the glory of the Lord. Another translation says they're recounting the honor of God. They're proclaiming God's splendor. Whew. Okay. The word declare means tell, make known, announce, or speak. They're announcing and speaking and saying, God's signature is on what you're looking at. There is a thus saith the Lord, or declares the Lord on what you're beholding. But the heavens are declaring what? What are they declaring? The glory. That's what we got to tap into. That's what we got to try to understand. What are the heavens saying? What are the heavens telling us? What are they proclaiming to us? God's what? Glory. The heavens are declaring his glory. What is his glory? This is where we just don't seem to cross over. A lot of churches don't even look for the glory. They don't recognize the glory. The Bible says that the earth will be filled with what? The knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. So we need the knowledge of the glory of God. Faith comes by what? Hearing. The more you hear about it, the more your faith is going to rise up. that you can understand and have knowledge of it and step into it. Oh, I hope that makes sense. This is one of those you're going to have to listen to, I think, again. The word glory, there's several words in the Bible that describe glory. One of them we were singing about was the Shekinah glory of God. The word here, where the heavens declare the glory of God, that word glory, it's one of the most used definitions in Hebrew for the word glory is kavod, which is the heavy, weighty glory of God. Now, when we think of heavy and weighty, a lot of times the Spirit of the Lord will come into a service, and what do we feel? Do you ever feel that? Do you ever feel when the Holy Spirit just comes in and it feels heavy, like you can't move? And we say that's the kavod of God, that's the heavy, weighty glory of God. But let me put it to you this way. The heavens are declaring the weight of God. We say of someone like President Trump or the king of a country that they carry a lot of what? Weight. Their words carry a lot of weight. What they say, their influence, their power carries a lot of weight. Amen? Amen. So the heavens are declaring the heaviness of God, the weight of God. I can't wait till we just get this. Another word for glory is to glorify or to beautify. In Isaiah 60 verse 7, it says, I will glorify, which is the word in the Hebrew, it's tipara, but it means I will beautify or glorify the house of my glory. That word is kavod. So I will beautify or I will glorify my house of my, that carries my heavy weight. Oh, I don't know if I can do this justice. I'm really trying. Okay. And I feel bad because I am competing and you're having to hear ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. And I apologize for that. But about a month or two, the glory cloud is moving down the road. Hallelujah. Now, the verse that we're going to focus on is chapter 60, verse 1. Isaiah 60, verse 1. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is what? Risen upon you. Man. He's speaking to his beloved. That's you. And he's saying, I want you to arise. I want you to shine. Because your light has come. How has your light come? The glory of the Lord, all that I was just trying to describe, which is just a little tiny minute dropper of what God's glory really is, has risen upon you. Oh, boy. This is an awful lot to grasp, and I'm just telling little baby steps of little baby, you know, what God, I'm spoon feeding you, okay? Arise and shine. Your light has come, and the glory of the Lord, I was trying to describe what his glory is. Another way of putting God's glory into a English understanding is all that he is and all that he does. All that he is. We can't even comprehend all that he is. All that he does. Can't comprehend. But it's risen upon you. Beyond this understanding. There is no way you can humanly comprehend the fact that God's glory, isn't that what it says, has risen upon you. First of all, when we think of glory, we think of it coming down. Shekinah glory falls. Let your glory fall. But this is saying his glory has risen upon you. His glory has risen upon you. Oh my God, that's why I can't stand up. Okay? Visualize this, please, what I'm doing for yourself. God's glory has risen upon you. Jesus' name. I want to read this to you in the Message translation. Are you ready? Get out of bed, Jerusalem. Wake up. Put your face in the sunlight. Face to face. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. What that translates is Jesus was face to face with God. He's saying here, put your face in the sunlight. Look at God. God's, excuse me, bright glory has risen upon you. None of us live like this. I don't know anybody that fully lives like this. They say Catherine Kuhlman, when she walked through an airport, people would fall over because she was such a carrier of the tangible, manifest glory presence of God that when she walked, people would, whoa, they'd swoon and say, what was that? We're not there yet, but this is where we're headed. You following me? To understand that this glory is on you already. If we can get this, it'll change your life. It'll change the church. He says, get out of bed, Jerusalem. Wake up. Put your face in the sunlight. God's bright glory has risen for you. The whole earth is wrapped in darkness. All the people sunk in deep darkness. But God rises on you. His sunrise breaks, glory breaks over you. Nations will come to your light. Kings to your sunrise brightness. That's the Message Bible. But it says God rises upon you in the midst of an earth that is covered in darkness. That says that we should be lights shining. But yet if you don't know that's what you are, you're going to think you're a part of that dark, gloomy world. Now, the word glory, the weightiness means what I was trying to describe before, that which is substantial or heavy. It means honor and splendor. It means power. It means wealth. It means authority. It means magnificence. It means fame, dignity, riches, and excellency. The glory of God, God's weightiness, God's substantial, heavy glory, his honor, his splendor, his power, his wealth, his authority, his magnificence, his fame, his dignity, his riches, and his excellency have risen upon you. That ought to change your life. The only reason you should hang your head is because it's so heavy. The glory that that is risen on me is so heavy, so weighty, so powerful, so authoritative, so magnificent, so huge, so glorious, that I can hardly carry it. But you should not be hanging your head because you're a nothing and a nobody going nowhere. You should not be hanging your head because you got nothing. The Bible says that he is the glory and lifter of your head. Just try studying the word glory. It'll blow your finite little mind. I've read every book I could find by Catherine Kuhlman on the glory. I went through the concordance and I looked up every scripture on the glory. I wrote out the meaning in every scripture on glory. I've studied it. I'm not an expert on it, but I love the word. It's not a word we use a lot. Not in America, not in our language. It's not a word that people talk about. But the Bible talks so much about it. The Bible says that we are to make his praise what? Glorious. And that God inhabits the praise. He lives in and dwells in the praise when we make it glorious. Man. I just want to be in there all the time. Which is why we started CRC, because we just want a place for him where his glory can dwell. But do you know what you're asking for? Do you comprehend what we're saying? Oh, I want a place for your glory to dwell. That's huge. That's all that he is and all that he does. Can you build a house big enough? Can you build a church big enough? But yet he says, here it is. My glory is risen upon you. Which means this is just the clarion and this is just the Rosendahl room. But when we come together, this becomes the house of God. Why? Because of the glory that we carry. Have you been to a church where they're not carrying the glory? Yes. It's not a church. It's dead. Yes. It's not alive. Because his glory is alive. Isaiah 60 verse 2 says that the glory of the Lord that's risen upon you, it says that the glory will rise over you and his glory will be seen upon you. Oh, Judy, I can't digest all this. I know, but I'm just still giving it to you and hoping that it'll bear some fruit. His glory is going to be seen on you.
Glory.
Yeah. When people walk through the doors, they should see the glory of God on us.
Wow.
Because the glory of the Lord has risen upon us.
Jesus.
Wow. Oh my gosh. Okay, we're just going to keep going. Romans 8:18 says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time, which is your light and momentary afflictions, are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us." Wow. You've been going through some stuff? Whatever you're going through is working out a weight of glory in you. It's working out a weight of glory in you. I think one of the reasons that God's glory isn't seen upon us is because we allow all the flesh garbage to be seen. and we act out the flesh instead of the spirit? What if we acted out the spirit? Whoa. Scripture says put on the new man. Fake it till you make it. Anybody try to put on the new man and the devil says, oh, you're a hypocrite. You don't really feel that way. Fake it till you make it. You'll become what you put on. But if the glory of the Lord is risen upon you, then we should be wearing the glory of God. Wow. Wow. Colossians 1:27 says, to them God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Okay, now we're getting somewhere even deeper with this. Because how is the glory of God risen upon you? Christ in you, the hope of glory. When you let him out, he rises upon you. Oh my gosh. The glory that resides within you is Christ. How is the glory going to be seen? When you let Jesus out. Wow. You like that, Mark? Let me check. Amen. So how will his glory be seen upon you? When you arise. The word arise means to come up, to get up, to stand up. What was the translation I just read? Get out of bed. Get out of bed and wake up. But it says, for notice or consideration. Part of the meaning is that when you arise, it's so that you can be noticed. Amen. Amen. That his glory can be seen. Because when you arise, you will shine. The word shine, listen to Webster's dictionary version. It says to emit or reflect light, to glow, to cause to shine, especially by polishing or cleaning. We like that one. Arise, shine. You've been being polished lately? You're going to glow if you allow the Lord to polish and shine you. Ooh. I can see you. It's like here. Yes, yes, yes. The glory of the Lord will be seen upon you. The glory of the Lord is the revelation of who he is. The revelation of who he is will be seen upon you. Oh boy, this is so deep, I can't even go all this way tonight. What is the image of God? What is the image of the Lord that you're going to be reflecting? Oh boy. His glory. And that word. There we go again. The word glory. Oh, I see God's glory. I feel God's glory. What is that? What is that? Is it something you can touch? You said, I feel it. Is it something you can see? But you said, I see it. How do you see it? A fog. A fog. Tony, you've seen a fog? Seen a cloud? Seen smoke? These are just little tiny manifestations, but they don't describe the glory. In the Old Testament, the glory of God filled the temple. And it says that the priests and the men, they couldn't even minister because the glory was so thick in the room. It's like if the glory cloud came in here so thick, I wouldn't even be able to see angel. I wouldn't be able to minister because I couldn't see you because it's so thick in here. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. If every one of us, this is such a tough revelation, but so glorious. Just the little bits you're getting is so cool. It's so awesome. It's so yummy, right? Taste and see that the Lord is good. It's so yummy, right? Yes. Yummy. I should tell you my little yummy story. I'll tell you that later. But anyway, we were in South America, and I don't speak the language. Poquito Espanol, you know? And everybody talks to me down there, bah, 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 like I know what they're saying, right? And it didn't dawn on me. Every restaurant we went to, I would say, oh, John, this is so yummy. This is so yummy. Because the food down there is so good in Colombia, so delicious. And I'd say, this is yummy. After being there about a week, his cousin Monica goes to me, what is yummy? What is yummy? I'm like, oh, muy, muy bueno. What was the word, honey? There's a word for that. I can't remember. Yeah, delicioso. There was another word that they were using. But it's so good. And when I talk about the Lord, taste and see that he is so good. He's yummy. He's yummy. His word is yummy. But the revelation is delicious. Are you getting that? The revelation is delicious. It's like, oh, the most wonderful taste to your palate, spiritually, right? Okay, now, the image of the Lord that's going to be seen upon you. There's so much to this that I can't even begin. In Exodus 33, verse 19, Moses says to the Lord, we sang this before, he begged God. He begged God. He was so bold, it says that he was one of the boldest and most humblest men, was Moses. But yet he's in God's face, begging God, show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. And we sing it and we pray it. And God loves that. Just like he loved when Moses asked him. But what was his answer? He says, I will cause all of my goodness to pass in front of you. You want to see my glory? First of all, he said, nobody can see my glory and live. He says, it'll kill you. You couldn't handle it in the natural. Why do we get slain in the spirit? Why do people start convulsing and jerking? Because your flesh can't handle it. That's a reaction of your flesh to the glory of God. In old revival meetings, I've never seen this yet, people would get smacked up against the wall and just be hanging there for the meeting. The glory, bam, just whoosh, knocked them. Your flesh can't handle the spirit. It doesn't know how to act. It doesn't know how to react. You know, some people fall down. Some people, wham. I've done both. Sometimes it's so powerful. I was at a Benny Hinn meeting, and the glory of God was so strong that when you walked up to the platform, as soon as they got close to the presence of the Lord, they were backflipping. They were, whoa, I can't even do it, and backflipped. With me, the power of God shot me like a bullet so hard I knocked over two of those big catchers. Boom! It's just like, bam! Because your flesh can't handle it. Wow. But he says, it'll kill you. But I'll show you all of my goodness. When we're asking God for his glory, we're really saying, show us all your goodness. Show us your miracles, your healings. Show us the words of encouragement, exhortation, and prophecy. Show us that you heal the brokenhearted and bind up their wounds. Show us all that you are. Show us your glory. man. He said, I will cause my goodness to, all of my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy. I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So he says, I'll show you all my goodness, I'll show you all my mercy, and I'll show you all my compassion. Man, for God, who lives way up there, to come down here and dwell with us, and not only dwell with us, but then raise us up and seat us up there with him spiritually, and give us all his authority, and says, not only will I give you all my authority, I will put myself in you. I will give you my power. I will give you my gifts. I will anoint you. I will put my spirit in you. Man, is that goodness? I will forgive you, mercy. I will heal you, compassion. I'll do all that because I'm going to show you my goodness. And when I do that, you are going to arise and shine. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I'm going to give you one more thing, and then we're going to close with this awesome song. I woke up with a song in my spirit, and Ed's such a good guy. I emailed him like about 2 o'clock, I don't know, 1 o'clock. I said, I need this song for tonight. And he downloaded it for us. The Greek word, one of the Greek words for glory is doxa. D-O-X-A. It's where we get the English word doxology. Yes, let the glory of the Lord hit you in there. I'm just going to make a joke of it now. What are you going to do? Oh, but listen to this. Blew me away. Because Webster's English Dictionary's definition of doxology is this. A short formula of praise to God. A short formula of praise to God is Webster's definition of doxology. That is so awesome. One of the Greek words for glory. The Bible commands us to glorify him. Praise is the greatest cure for depression because it gets your focus off of your flesh.